I would like to introduce you to somebody very, very special who's sort of been the pioneer of this industry, or, you know, as I say, the godfather of the food or the restaurant industry. And he's been one person who supported us all through the 6 years back when I started the Restaurant India Congress show at Franchise India. He sort of gave us the spirit and the energy to go on. So ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. Niren Chaudhary, who's the global president of KFC. And so he's been there with, he has a career which spans over 25 years. Most of it is actually a part of Yum Brands, the Pizza Hut and KFC we know today. He's globally heading KFC in lots of countries. But I think what is really most special about him is as a person. So he's, for me, I've always thought of him as a complete person. He's been able to do his, as a professional, he's a wonderful professional. As a person, he's a great person. I think he's been able to do sort of everything together so beautifully. I think he's a person we chose today to present in front of you right now, a keynote, as well as share his own life journey, his business journey, his professional journey with you about how he grew Yum Brands and how he's managed to still be, you know, into so many things that he can tell you about it himself. So Niren, if we could please welcome you up here on the stage. I leave it with you, Niren, from here on.
So good evening. I don't know if being called the godfather is a compliment or not. I think I've grown my beard a little bit, so probably matches the description. It's fantastic to be here in Bangalore. I now live in, as Ritu was saying, I've been with Yum for about 23 years, 10 in Europe, and 10, the most enjoyable 10 years in India. And till 2 years back, I was heading up the India business, looking after Pizza Hut, KFC, Taco Bell, and recently moved to Dallas about 2 years back as the global president for KFC. I now look after close to 6,000 stores in over 55 countries. But my favorite place to, thank you. My favorite place to visit is India by far, and India's home. And I think, particularly coming to Bangalore, and I was driving from the airport today, and I was remembering how we at Yum Brands chose Bangalore every single time to open the first store of each one of our brands. And you know, and Bangalore has been really, really special to us. So the first KFC, as you may remember, was on Brigade Road. The first Pizza Hut, Prestige Road. And then the first Taco Bell as well. You know, everything has happened here. And it's got, therefore, a very special place in my heart. And then I think I was also thinking of some incredible brands that we have in South India. So whenever I travel to Chennai, for example, the first thought in my mind is Saravana Bhavan. Saravana Bhavan in my mind, first thing. I have to go there, I have to have that thali, and then I have to have that incredible lychee ice cream. And then of course, Paradise Biryani in Bangalore. You know, now actually run by some friends of mine, it's just incredible. And I've always wondered, these brands have, they, you know, follow the rule book of building global businesses perfectly. I think these brands can be global iconic brands. You know, these brands have the richness and the focus that you would want in any brand anywhere in the world. And I wish these brands a huge amount of success. And may they be there forever, because I absolutely love them. So I thought today, you must have had, you know, a lot of conversations about building businesses and so on. And I thought I'd probably build on that and share with you some of my own perspectives and what I've learned. With KFC, Pizza Hut, Taco Bell. And before that, I was with the Tatas for about 8 years, working for the Taj Group of Hotels. You know, I've really been privileged to have really, really interesting exposure. So here is it. You know, I've asked myself very often, why do we work? And ask yourselves this, why is it that we work? Why do we get up every morning and start working? What is it about? Why are we working? I think it's an important question. Why are we doing what we're doing? What's going on? And I think when I ask myself that, I think of two things. One is, I think I have to create shareholder value, undoubtedly. But I also believe that we as leaders have to create community impact. You know, we have to make the world a better place. So we have to do both things. We have to create shareholder value, and then we also have to create community impact. And then the question is, so how do you really do that? If that is what business is all about, then how do you do that? And I believe three things. Number one, you need to have a very clear brand, clear definition of what your proposition and your brand is. And within that, I would suggest thinking about the following. What's the purpose of my brand? Why do I exist? What is my proposition for the brand? What am I serving to consumers that is distinctive from competition? What are the principles basis which my brand is so unique and distinctive? And finally, what is the personality of my brand? So the first pillar almost is about, you know, building a strong, iconic brand by having clarity on some of these questions. So for me to perhaps illustrate that with an example, I'll take KFC. So how many of you like KFC, Kentucky Fried Chicken? Oh man, that's sort of heartbreaking, about 30% of the room. Okay, how many? Okay, I like some people are raising both their arms, some people raising their legs as well. So how many of you like KFC or Pizza Hut or Taco Bell? Maybe I have more success with that. Well, that's still only half the room. Anyways, I think you haven't had enough alcohol, so. So to give you an example of KFC, so KFC, purpose of KFC. So we said, well, you know, why does KFC exist? Well, we see that, we say that KFC helps you discover the true you, because the food is so craveable that it can be yourself and indulge in that craveable experience of finger-licking good food. So the purpose of the brand is to help you discover the real you. The proposition for KFC, we say, is craveable, irresistible food at reasonable prices. That's our proposition. Principles, well, it's always freshly prepared. It's got the Colonel's secret recipe, and it's always got real chicken. And personality, it's real, authentic. So, as I described, these define what the brand ought to be, and then we bring that to life in everything that we do, in our assets, our communication, in our service, in our products, and so on. So if the purpose of business is to create shareholder value and to have community impact, the first thing that each one of us out here have to do is to think about your respective brands and ask yourself, do I have clarity of purpose, of proposition, of principles, and personality? If you have that, the second thing you need to therefore work on is your business model. Do I have a business model where my investment will be paid back in under 3 years? Well, that's very important. And how can I craft at the back of this proposition a business model so I get my returns back? And then the third thing is, if I have a strong brand and if I have a strong business model, then I will start growing. So how do I grow? And how do I grow in a disciplined way? And if you do these three things, which is a brand, a business model, and disciplined growth, you will create shareholder value, and you will also have the opportunity to create community impact. So that's my kind of business philosophy. However, to be able to, this is perhaps nothing new, you all know this, but what is different is, to be able to do this, you need people. You need people capability. You need the best possible talent that you can find. And even that is not enough. I believe more than that, you need to create a culture. You need to create a culture that can unleash the full potential of the people who work for you and help you achieve and create shareholder value and make community impact. So I think eventually it comes down to building great culture, and what I want to talk to you about is culture and my thoughts on culture. I think as Peter F. Drucker said, you know, culture eats strategy for breakfast. If you really want to fulfill your dreams as leaders and create shareholder value and community impact, to me, the true differentiator is how you create an empowering culture. And if you're able to create a culture of trust, where your employees and everybody that works for you trusts and supports each other as they do in their own family, then you know that the enemy is not within the four walls, the enemy is outside, the enemy is competition, it's not each other. And people are then focused without any distraction to do what is required to do to execute against the brand proposition, a strong business model, and drive growth. So culture for me is massively, massively, hugely important. So what is culture? Culture to me is simply is how we behave. You know, how we speak, how we talk, how we interact, how we treat each other, that to me is culture, our behavior. And therefore, if we want to create a culture of trust, we can do that only if our behavior is consistent, right? Predictable. That people can predict, this is how things are done in this company. And therefore, to have predictable behavior, you need to have predictable thoughts. To have predictable thoughts, you need to have a common shared platform of values. If you have common values in your organization, you have consistent thinking. If you have consistent thinking, you have consistent behavior. If you have consistent behavior, then you have a culture of trust. So it really comes down to, and ask yourselves this right now, have you taken the time to identify and articulate what your core values and beliefs are for your organization and for your enterprise? And if you haven't, here's the thing. If you haven't articulated it explicitly, there's an implicit value expression that is already happening, whether you like it or not. And there's a culture that is being formed, you know, even if you are not controlling it. So it's much better for you to be able to be mindful of it, understand the potential and the importance of a culture of trust, and then say, okay, what are some of the core values that I want all my employees to share so that their thinking is consistent at the back of those consistent values, and then their behaviors will be consistent, and therefore, I will have trust. And if I have trust, I can unleash the full potential of the people who work in my organization and achieve incredible success. So then if that is true and culture is most important and culture of trust is most important, then whose responsibility is culture? I really believe the culture begins with each one of you in your organization. It begins with the leader. I think this culture is something you can't delegate. It begins with you, it begins with your behavior, then it begins with you and your leadership team, and then it has to be owned by every single employee in the organization, because I believe that culture is not merely an expectation, it's an obligation. Each person has to say, well, I embrace these values, and I will live and die by these values. And if you get that level of commitment in your organization, then the culture will truly flourish and come alive. But it starts with you. It starts with you, right? Starts with you. So it's not something that somebody will come and do for you or the HR department or somebody else. It starts with you. You cannot delegate culture building. You have to role model it. You have to define what those values are. And then you have to hire people against those cultural values. Hire people who live and embody those values. Then you want to grow people who reflect those values, and you want to take out people who do not live by the values. And you become the guardian at the gate of the culture of your organization. You know, fiercely protecting it. Fiercely protecting it. Making sure you let in only people who believe in what you believe in. And then letting go of people who perhaps don't. So that is what culture means to me, and that's why culture is so important. And what I thought I will do with you tonight is share with you some 5 or 6 principles of values that Yum believes in, that are our common values that we believe and we execute against 140 countries. Think about that. We have over 40,000 restaurants across all 3 brands in over 140 countries. And we're able to, because we have this common blueprint of common values, we're able to create and recreate and recreate and recreate the same culture in different countries all over the world. And that is absolutely fascinating. It's one of the many things that I admire about Yum so much. So what I'll do is, and I picked up some cultural values, which are not the generic, you know, everybody talks about customer delight and employee satisfaction and all that. I won't pick up the generic stuff. I'll pick up some of the values that are maybe slightly different. And more importantly, I'll give you my own personal sort of interpretation of that. And then also how I bring it to life. So that you get a sense of how important these values are. But also perhaps you also then start thinking about what might be those values that resonate with you. And how might you bring that to life in your organization? Because believe me, culture is the true differentiator of greatness and excellence in organizations. So, with that, let's get into the first one. The value, the first one is, you know, belief in all people. So what this means to me is that everybody is important. I believe that all human beings are good. Everybody is good. And I haven't met a single person who's not motivated, who doesn't want to do well. And therefore, I think the task of a leader is not to motivate people, it's how not to demotivate people. Because people are intrinsically born motivated, and I haven't met a single person who doesn't want to do well in life. I also believe that belief in people for me means that everybody can make a difference, everyone can add value, it doesn't matter what your job title is. I also believe that diversity creates incredible strength in an organization. Diversity of gender, diversity of race, diversity of ability, all of those things. The more diverse your organization is, the more rich it will be. I believe in all people. I believe in people. I believe that people are the most important capital that you can have in your organization. And I know that I'm not saying something that you're not aware of. But what is important is that, what do you do with this? So if you all believe, would you all believe that all human beings are born motivated? Would you believe that? Yes? And people want to basically do well and they want to become the best that they can be. If that is true, then it is our job as leaders to unleash that full potential in each one of the people who works with us and make the people who work with us much better than they ever thought was possible, by making them believe that they're capable of doing much more than they ever thought was possible. Growing people around us. That is the job of every single leader. If you truly believe in the limitless potential of the people in our organizations, ask yourself, do you really do that? Do you really think about that and spend time doing it? In fact, I love this quote, which is that the job of any leader is to build the self-confidence of the people around him and make them feel 12 feet tall. As you can tell, I'm still working on myself. But 12 feet tall. I really believe that if you believe in the limitless potential of human beings, then it is your job as a leader to make sure that you're helping unleash that limitless potential that people have around us. So the question is, how do you do that? How do you become a multiplier of talent? How do you become a leader who can actually inspire and grow people around him so that they become much better than they ever thought was possible? How do you do that? And I think if you were having an interaction or we had more time, I think many of you would say, well, you delegate, you train, you empower, right? That's how you grow people. That is something we know. Let me share with you something which was a unique insight for me. I realized that growing other people is not only about what you do with them, it's about what you do with yourself. In fact, it is more important how you control yourself to grow other people. That was a big revelation for me. You know, it is not only I have to train him, I have to empower him, I have to delegate. No, that's okay. But the real catalyst is, are you working on yourself? And let me give you some examples. And the way to look at this for each one of us is invariably to look at your strengths. Think of whatever your strength is potentially what will limit your ability to grow people. So for example, one of my strengths is I'm very, very, very passionate. You know, I have as you may be able to tell, I have a point of view on almost everything. And then if I have the advantage of having positional power, so I'm the president, global president, etc., you know, and I walk into a room, then I have positional power. And then obviously, if I speak, that has a disproportionate weight in the room in which I'm in. And therefore, I realize that if I don't check myself, and speak a lot and have a point of view and show everybody, you know, that I have thought about so many things. If I don't control myself, I will not build the confidence of the people around me. And what was a strength, therefore, for me was also a limitation in being able to grow the confidence of people working with me. So I did two things. One was I came up with this three marble rule. So I said I'll walk into a room with three marbles, not literally, but you know, I'll think I have only three marbles in my pocket. And every time I speak, I will lose one marble. So I'll speak only three times in a meeting. So every time I lose that marble, I ask myself, is this really worth losing my marble? And then I'd invariably bite my tongue and keep quiet. I found that to be very useful. A second technique I picked up was to just stay silent and be comfortable with silence. So walk into the room, sit down, and not say anything. Or be the last one to speak. And if some people are waiting and looking at me and saying, what's wrong with this guy? Normally we can't shut him up, and today he's very quiet. Be comfortable with that silence. And somebody will invariably step in, and somebody will invariably grow. And therefore, I wanted to share with you that, because people are, you know, we don't realize it, but all of you are leaders, you're entrepreneurs, you're owners, you're presidents, you're CEOs. You have more power than you realize. You walk into a room and people are actually intimidated. They think that, you know, you are so successful, and therefore they're looking to you all the time for guidance. But I think that then stunts and limits your ability to grow people around you, and you have to actually realize that and hold yourself back so that you can let other people grow. So therefore, believe in all people. If it is about unleashing the potential of people around us, it's not only about working on them, it's about working on yourself. And a good place for you to start would be whatever you think is your strength. This was my example. I'm sure you can reflect on your own and say, okay, I think I'm good at this. That is the point, that is the place where you ought to actually reflect and say, well, how might that be limiting my confidence ability, building ability of the people who work with me? So build the self-confidence of the people around you by keeping yourself in check, was my sort of insight. A second value is to, you know, go for breakthrough. I said, yum, we talk about this fact of we're not interested in incremental results, 1%, 2%, 3%, 4%. We don't want sort of business as usual. We want breakthrough. We want big, hairy, audacious, humongous, astronomical, phenomenal, disproportionate, incredible results. You know, stuff that you may not have ever thought of or not have had the courage to go for. And if you want an organization that has that kind of spirit, that kind of intentionality, that kind of a passion, belief, to go for nothing but the very best, the question is, as leaders, how do you do that? Everybody gets this idea that, you know, you must go for breakthrough. And even your competitors probably think about it. Then the question is, why is it that not all organizations are able to achieve it? Why is it that only some organizations are able to achieve it? And I believe that to be able to achieve this spirit of going for growth, breakthrough, which is not just incremental results, but breakthrough results, you need a certain spirit of resilience in the company. And I'm a big believer of creating resilience in a company, both personally and professionally. And I love this quote by Winston Churchill, that success is nothing but moving from failure to failure to failure to failure to failure to failure and to more failure without losing enthusiasm. I love that. In fact, Churchill also wrote something else which in my dark moments always manages to lift me. He says that success is never final. If any of you here are feeling successful, I have good news to share with you. It will not last. Right? Success is never final. And those who might be feeling like failures, I have good news for you, that failure is not never fatal. Both are transient. And what matters is that every time you get knocked down, you get up. That's what matters. You get up because that is what is there in your control. You cannot help. See, success and failure is not entirely up to you. It's a function of many different things. what is in your control is that every time you get knocked down, and you will get knocked down, you have the courage to stand up one more time. And I take a lot of courage from this statement. And whenever I'm feeling sort of, you know, demolished, I say, I'm going to stand up one more time. I'm going to stand up. I'm going to stand up again. And I'm going to stand up again. And I'm going to keep standing up, because that's what I can do. So think about that. If you want to create that kind of a spirit in your organization, how do you do that? One, of course, is as leaders, you have to role model it in your personal life. So whatever happens to you, you have to get up, put a smile on your face, and keep going. But how do you create that in an organization? And my sort of learning there has been, is if you think of your organization as a catalyst for the people to discover their true human potential, that your organization becomes a caring organization through which the people who work with you can discover their true human potential, they will keep getting up, they will keep getting up, and they will keep fighting the good fight. Nothing will keep them down. And there are three things I believe that are important to do that, to help your organization to become a catalyst for true human potential. First of all is to have clarity of purpose, which is, people don't get inspired by financial goals. You know, let's make 30% more profit. Let's earn 3 crore more profit. Let's have market share of 27.32%. Nobody gets inspired by that, right? Because we as human beings, we long to have a more meaningful impact in the world around us. And I think companies who can tap into that sense of purpose and the desire in all of us to have a higher calling are able to therefore create that sense of purpose for the people around us. So therefore, in an organization, we talk about, you know, a company with a big heart to make a difference to the communities around us. And we talk about, that's the reason why we do our business. We want to make sure that we're a catalyst to make a difference in the communities in which we operate. That's our purpose. So you need to have purpose. Then you need to have autonomy. You need to make sure that you give enough empowerment to the people so that they don't feel stifled, and they have the space for them to express and grow their human potential. And you give them mastery. You give them a chance to become the very best that they can be by investing in them and making them absolute rock stars. So three things. Clarity of purpose. Why do you exist? Why is your business important? And take it to a higher level. A level which can resonate with the hearts and minds of the people who work with you. Give them an opportunity for mastery, to really become the very best that they can be at whatever they're doing. And then finally, give them enough freedom, autonomy to express themselves. Make your organization a catalyst for allowing human potential to flourish, and you will find that there'll be such incredible resilience in your company that any time your company gets hit, the employees will stand up one more time. One more time. So be the creator of passion and energy in your teams, and the three things, like I said, is purpose, mastery, and autonomy. The next one is building know-how. And this is particularly a favorite one of mine. And let me tell you a story. So how many of you have heard of Socrates? So it's the same 30% who love Yum Brands, I think. The others, are still waiting to just get the hell out and drink some booze. So Socrates is a Greek philosopher. And Socrates was a very, very wise man, a very smart man. And some other not-so-wise men went to the king one day and said, King, King, the Socrates is very smart. So I think we ought to go and ask him, what is the secret of his wisdom? So the king said, well, that's a good idea. I think you ought to go there and you ought to ask him. So these wise men go and they speak to Socrates and say, Socrates, Socrates, what is the secret of your wisdom? So Socrates looks a little perplexed and he says, it's quite simple, really. I know what I don't know. So he said, and? He said, that's it. He says, surely Socrates, that cannot be so. They run back to the king and say, king, king, this Socrates is a dishonest man. He doesn't like to share his secrets of success and wisdom, and he's giving us this bullshit answer. So I suggest he be imprisoned and he be threatened with death. And then perhaps he will tell us what the secret is. King says, good idea. King had believed in autonomy, mastery, empowerment, peace, you know. So he said, I must always support my employees. Good idea. Encourage them. Build their self-confidence. So the wise men rush off and they imprison Socrates. And Socrates is about to be killed the next day. And on the penultimate day, they go to Socrates and say, Socrates, you're about to be killed tomorrow. Surely now it is time, if you want to escape death, to tell us the secret of your wisdom. He said, I already told you. Yeah, tell us again. I know what I don't know. Socrates, you are absolutely impossible. Are you not afraid of dying? He said, how can I be afraid of something that I don't know? At which point, I think the wise men killed themselves. No, that's just poetic license. I don't know what happened. But I thought this was an incredible story, which just captures in it this beautiful truth of the secret of wisdom is to just realize that none of us know anything. And if we have that attitude, we will always be hungry and curious. We won't have the ego of and the arrogance of knowledge. We know, if you think of the universe of knowledge, what do we know? We know nothing. Maybe our knowledge is like not even a speck. So let me do a little bit of an exercise with you so that you really remember this. Close your eyes, stretch your hands out with your palms facing the ceiling. So your palms facing the ceiling, eyes closed, please indulge me. Come on, come on. Not on the phone, I mean, you can't call a friend, you know. Just stretch your palms out, eyes closed. This is the best part about training, I can make you do anything I want. No. Keep your palms out. Keep your palms out. So repeat after me. I know nothing. I never knew anything. I will never know anything. I am completely devoid of all possible knowledge. So help me, God. You're hereby released of your arrogance of knowledge. No, you don't have to say that. That's what I'm saying to you. So imagine imagine what your employees will think. They say, look at these guys. They're supposed to be, you know, the CEOs, the owners, the senior leaders, the captains of the F&B industry. But the truth is, let me tell you, none of you know anything. I know nothing. You know nothing. None of us know anything. Right? We can only share a perspective at a particular point in time, and even that may change the next day, right? So I think if we embrace this reality of we know nothing and we become childlike once again, we become curious, right? We look at the world with new eyes and we want to learn. We want to learn from people. We want to ask people, I like this about you. Teach me. Tell me how you do that, you know? We don't have these competitive barriers. I can't speak to my competition. I can't speak to my supplier. I can't do this. I can't do that. You connect at a human level and say, I'm going to learn from anybody. I'm going to learn everything I can from everybody. So therefore, I think out here, like Socrates says, I know what I don't know. I found that a very powerful story. But the best way to stay on this lifelong journey of learning, I think, is two things. One is be a student. You know, be a jigyasu balak or jigyasu balike, right? I think, you know, and now I think with internet and so much, there's so much information available. Make sure that you're spending a significant percent of your time actually, you know, absorbing and learning and growing and then relearning and then unlearning and then relearning and unlearning and then relearning. And then just keep doing that all your life. In fact, I believe that my purpose in life is just learning. That's it. I want to learn. I want to just get better and better and learn and learn and learn. Then I want to unlearn and unlearn and unlearn, and I want to relearn and relearn and relearn. So being a student, I think, is great. But also being a teacher taking time to share your perspectives with your employees. And that's the reason I love talking to people, is it helps me sort of internalize, it helps me, you know, reflect on some of my own experiences. I find it terribly enriching. And do the same. So be a student, be a teacher, and keep that hunger and that flame of seeking knowledge consistently alive in your heart all the time. From people, from competitors, from suppliers, from books, from internet, from magazines, from videos, whatever works for you, audio books, doesn't matter. But make sure that you're constantly, constantly learning. So that's building know-how. So far we've talked about three values. Belief in people, remember we talked about that? If you believe that all people are good, then you as leaders have to unleash the full potential of people who work for you, which is as much about them, but even more importantly about what you do and how you control yourself to help build the confidence of people around you. The second we talked about was going for breakthrough, going for dramatically audacious results, and how to be able to create that resilience in an organization. Three things: purpose, autonomy, and mastery. And the third one was know-how. Having this mindset of building know-how, always being curious and hungry for learning and knowledge all the time. So the fourth one is teamwork, which is how can you create teamwork in your organization, which is like take the hill, which is, you know, nimble, and it is efficient, and it is very quick and surgical, and very committed, and for the long term, and it is creating something which is magnificent, and it's built on trust, and it is long-term and sustainable. So to explore this, please indulge with me. If I were to take the metaphor of animals and say, for me to have exceptional teamwork, what kind of employees will I have? And use the metaphor of animals. How many of you would want lions in your team to have exceptional teamwork? Lions. Not even one person wants a lion. Okay, there's a thank you for bailing me out. There's one lion. Well, when I do this, people say, listen, there's two. Thank you so much. See, the lion's life is a very good life. You know who does all the work? The lioness. So the lion sits there. He switches TV channels, drinks pina colada. It's a pretty good life. Pretty good life. But, you know, lions are not long-term, not sustainable, because once they have a hunt, their stomach is full. And then they become lazy, they go to sleep. So that doesn't work. What about wolves? Metaphor of wolves. How many of you would want wolves? Wolves work in packs. They're team-orientated. How many of you would want wolves? So do I take that as a yes? You would want a wolf as part of your team? Yes? Strategic? Okay, so some few hands raising here and there at the back. Yeah, okay, wolves. So wolves actually also are not long-term and not team-orientated, because wolves are in a pack as long as the pack is doing well. If the pack is not doing well, they go to the other pack. So they are what we guys call dal badlus. So we don't want wolves. You know, that's not a great attitude, that they're with you only if your company is doing well. But the minute your company gets hit, these are the first guys who put their resumes out and who leave the company. We don't want that. So then what kind of animals do we want? We actually want bees, right? We want bees. And we want ants. And these are animals who have the orientation and the attitude of being team players. For them, the collective good is better than the individual good. That's their attitude. And what they build is a beehive or an anthill which survives for a long, long time. It's long term. And it's for the greater good of the community, right? So therefore, the analogy and the metaphor of, if you agree, would you agree, bees and ants? Yeah? So then the analogy is that if that is true, then we need to hire employees who have the bee and the ant attitude. Because let me tell you this, teamwork is all about attitude. And it is 100% function of recruitment. 100% function of recruitment. You have to hire for attitude, and you can train for skill. But you cannot train for attitude. And therefore, so important for all of us, if you want exceptional companies with tremendous teamwork, is to hire bees and ants and that type of attitude in the people around us. Because if you have that, and then you have to just love them and care for them as your own family, and you will have magic happen. It's not very complicated. Just like you love and care for your family, if you hire bees on your knees and ants in your pants, I think you can have a phenomenal teamwork in the organization. So don't be a wolf, don't be a lion, don't be a spider, be a bee. If you want to truly achieve exceptional teamwork. So collect bees in your organization and think right now as I'm talking to you, how many bees do you have in your organization? And how many spiders, wolves, lions, and other such animals you might have? And therefore, how might you then convert their attitude into the attitude of bees and ants? And then the next one is one of my favorites, is recognition. Recognition, I think, is a very important value which you create, and this is like, I think, a hallmark of Yum, is that we want to create a culture of catching people doing things right. Not catching them doing things wrong. The mindset is, I'm looking for success, I'm looking for who is succeeding, who is contributing, who's doing well, and I want to catch people doing things right. And I want to recognize them in a very unique and personal way, in a way in which it kind of comes from the heart and really makes a difference. So let me share with you some of my personal recognition awards that I've been giving up at Yum. And I think here Jack Welch captures it very well, that clap for every achievement, no matter how small, with everybody around you. And that's a hell of a lot more important than any finite strategy. I really love that, and I really believe that. So here's an example of some of my awards. So starting from the right to the left, so I have the Snake Charmer Award. This I gave when I was working in India. And the Snake Charmer Award I give for mesmerizing performance. When I get truly mesmerized, Snake Charmer Award for really outstanding achievements from people, where they have mesmerized me with something that is truly dramatic. Then I have this Bal Hanuman Award in the middle, which I now give out globally to every market that I go to. I'm very proud of this one. When I introduce this award, I tell them, and this is in various countries all over the world, that, you know, in India, you know how many gods we have? 350 million gods. And times like demonetization, you really call on all 350 million. Help me, God. Right? So 350 million gods. And then people ask me, why do you have 350 million gods for 1.2 billion people? I said, well, every god, we have a god for every problem that we have. In India, we have many problems. And therefore, for every problem, we pray to one specific god. So they find it quite fascinating. But Bal Hanuman, for me, kind of epitomizes the best of the best. He's the pace setter. He's the guru of all awards. And he reflects the goodness of what we have in our history and our great culture about, you know, of achievement and about going for breakthrough, etc. So I give that Bal Hanuman Award to various people. He's also got a Gadha. Gadha as in, right, Gadha. Not the Gadha. But and for me, that reflects his ability to go break through all barriers and achieve the impossible. And then I have the Kai Po Chi Award, inspired by the movie that came, Kai Po Chi. And I give this for a particularly clever competitive work. You know, when you do competitive work that has taken the kite of the competitor down, then I'd give a Kai Po Chi Award. So the lesson here was that just to have personalized your awards, have a story around it, have fun while you do it, and have a culture of catching people doing things right. In fact, one of my favorite portions, the picture that you see at the bottom is the ceiling of my office that used to be in India. It has the pictures of all the recognitions I've done when I travel, you know, all cities in India. And I capture and honor the people who are doing exceptional work, take it back, and then I hang it in my office. So everybody knows that if I recognize somebody, it is so important to me that I want to look at it every day and I want it all over my office. So by the time I left, I had my whole office, all my walls, ceiling, everything covered with pictures of my employees doing an exceptional job. And it was a way of remaining grounded and making myself realize that the only reason I exist is to serve the people on the front line. And my job is to motivate them and inspire them and let them know that what they do every single day is truly important. And this was a way of sort of bringing that to life. And finally, the final value is about big heart. You know, I'm very passionate about, I said to you that the role of us as leaders is to create shareholder value, but also community impact. And I believe that it would be amiss if we as leaders here were not to do something to make a difference in the community in which we operate and make this world a better place. And I want to share a few examples with you today with an idea of hopefully stimulating your thoughts and hopefully having you also commit yourself to doing something to make a difference in this great country of ours. And I think I used to tell my Yum India employees that, listen, we have no control over the country, so why can't we in Yum India be the country that we wish to see? Now, we have full control over the company in which we operate, so why can't the company be the country that we wish to see? And why can't the company that we own, and why can't the company that each one of us steward, why can't that be the model India that we wish to see? Why can't our companies reflect the country that we wish to see? And therefore, we embrace this aspect of diversity, diversity of gender, diversity of ability, and so on. And to give you an idea, one of the things we embraced was, I feel passionately about, is women and representation of women in the workforce. And as you all know, 1.2 billion people, half of that is women, and women not equally represented in our workforce, especially when it comes to leadership positions, or even in a food retail environment and restaurant industry like ours, on the front line, we just don't have enough women. And I think it is only when leaders like ourselves, we stand up and say, I will not accept this. And even though it's difficult, I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it not because it's easy, I'm going to do it because it's hard, and because I believe it ought to be done. So what we did at Yum was, we're going to open the first all-woman restaurant in Darjeeling, in KFC. Everybody, every single employee in that store is a woman. All the managers, all the team members, everybody is a woman. And we want to have at least one lady shift manager in every single restaurant that we have in the country. We have about 800 stores. And that was a commitment that we made, and that's what we hold our employees and ourselves accountable to. And I feel very proud that we're able to push that venture forward. The second one, how am I doing on time? Pretty poorly, I think. So I'll just take, where's Ritu? Is she here? Yeah, just a couple of minutes. Okay, so this one is, again, something very close to my heart. It's the hearing and speech impaired initiative in KFC, where we said, you know, we want to actually make a difference in the lives of those who are hearing and speech impaired. And we said we will do it in a different way. We will come up with 20 stores that are unique stores in which the hearing and speech impaired are in majority and the hearing employees are in minority. And because we want to inverse the world for the hearing and speech impaired, we want them to feel, what does it feel like if they were running the whole world? And therefore, in these stores, we have 20-odd stores, we employ more than 400 employees. 60 to 70% of our employees are hearing and speech impaired, and the hearing employees have to learn sign language to get along. The managers have to learn sign language to get along, and the hearing and speech impaired employees are expected to do every single job that a hearing employee is expected to do. Let me show you a quick clip in the words of Shrikant to explain what that means to him. Please play the video. Thank you. So that's what I wanted to share with you. Thank you for your time. I know it's a bit late, but I'm passionate about this, so I thought I wanted to really make sure I share my learnings and perspectives with you. So to recap, culture is the secret glue. Culture is about creating trust. Culture is all about having shared set of values, and I shared with you six of the core values that shape the culture at Yum. Belief in people. We talked about going for breakthrough. Talked about building know-how, take the hill teamwork, recognition, and then finally doing all of this with a big heart so that we as leaders are making a difference not only to our shareholders, but also to the community in which we work. Thank you very much for listening and have a great evening. Thank you. Ritu requested that if I could sing a few songs. I'm very fond of music. I have a band of my own from college days, and we still play. So I'll sing a few of my favorite songs. I'll start off with the most contemporary song that I know, because I know that there's a bit of a generation gap here. So hopefully this, you'll connect with this. Gonna be the day when they go and throw it back to you. Right now you should have realized, but there's nothing that I've got to do. I don't believe in anybody who feels the way I do about you now. Like me, the word is on the street, but the fire in your heart is hot. I know you should have looked before, but you never really had it done. I don't believe in anybody who feels the way I do about you now. And all the roads that lead us there are winding, and all the lights that lead us there are blinding. There are many things that I would like to say to you, but I don't know how. And I say maybe, got to be the one that saves me. And after all, you're my wonderwall. Clap with me, maybe. Got to be the one that saves me. And after all, you're my wonderwall. Thank you. So I take it some of you have heard the song. I saw you singing there, which is good. So I think I'll do one which everybody can sing as the finale. No, I have to go. Okay. So this one is by, it's a song done by Clapton, Bob Dylan, Guns N' Roses, and many other people. So can you guess which one? I think you'll know the song. Everybody knows the song. Huh?
Mm-hmm.
Let's practice the chorus.
Knock, knock, knocking on heaven's door. Knock, knock, knocking on heaven's door.
Let me hear you sing it louder. Brilliant. I always loved Bangaluru.
Mama, take these guns away from me. And I can't shoot it anymore. It's getting dark, too dark to see. I feel like I'm knocking up heaven's door.
Sing with me.
1, 2, 3, 4. Knock, knock, knocking on heaven's door. Knock, knock, knocking on heaven's door. Knock, knock.
Come on, you can do better.
Mama, take this badge away from me. And I can't use it anymore. It's getting dark, too dark to see. I feel like I'm knocking on heaven's door.
Sing with me.
1, 2, 3, 4. Knock, knock, knocking on heaven's door. Knock, knock, knocking on heaven's door.
Without the guitar.
Knock, knock, knocking on heaven's door.
So I can hear you.
Knock, knock, knocking on heaven's door.
Thank you. Do you want a Hindi song?
Yeah.
You like Mohit, Mohit Chauhan?
बन गया हूँ मैं चाहने तेरी
डूबा डूबा रहता हूँ मैं तेरी
दीवाना बन गया हूँ मैं चाहत में तेरी अब दिन गुजरते नहीं रात कटते नहीं तस्वीर से बात बनती नहीं तू आ जा
पहचाने ना ये हुआ कैसे तुम आ गए ख्वाबों में ऐसे बेवफा सो
बेवफा बेवफा
ना जा बेवफा डूबा डूबा रहता हूँ आँखों में तेरे दीवाना बन गया हूँ मैं चाहत में तेरे अब दिन गुजरते नहीं रात कटते नहीं दस देर से पल बनती नहीं तू आ जा
संजीव थोड़ा कमल सिंह
Ooh la la yeah, la 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 yeah. Ooh la 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 yeah, la 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 la.
Give Sanjeev a big hand.
Ooh la 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 yeah, la 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 yeah. Ooh la 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 yeah.
Wow. Only if I knew. So we tested something yesterday in Jaipur. And this is cooking and singing, full band. There were 9 of us. So I said, if I only, I play percussions, I play drums. I don't sing, but yeah. I only wish we could have jammed.
Yeah.
But anyway, Mohit Chauhan.
Yeah, I had another Mohit Chauhan I know is.
जरा नजर उठा के देखो बैठे हैं हम यहीं बेखबर मुझसे क्यों हो इतने बुरे भी हम नहीं जरा नजर उठा के देखो बैठे हैं हम यहीं बेखबर मुझसे क्यों हो
नो
इतने पु आई
टेल यू व्हाट
जरा नजर उठा के देखो बैठे हैं हम यहीं बेखबर मुझसे क्यों हो इतने बुरे पे हम नहीं आँखों का जादू पूरी दुनिया में है दुनिया की इस भीड़ में सबसे पीछे हम खड़े
All right, संजीव टेक इट अवे
महफिलें आई और गई लोग आए और गए तुम जो आज आए हो दिल में हो बस गए मुस्कुरा के ना
All right. Thank you guys. Thank you.